It's arguably the biggest year this sport has ever had, and we're here to meet England's general, back where it all started.
It's interesting because Kevin always says he's not the most talented player of his generation. He wasn't the most naturally gifted, but he decided that he would work the hardest.
I thought, you know, I want to be the best out there, but when I saw Kev, that all went down pan because I thought he's the best player.
Mentally very tough player, you know, nothing really phases him, and that kind of inspires you that he can come up with the big players under pressure at the right time, and that's what you need your captains to do.
What I am sure about is that he's the world's best prepared player, full stop, simple as that.
So this is where it all started, Kev. And what memories do you have of growing up playing here?
Yeah, it's great to be back. I don't live too far away, but started back there at the clubhouse, really. I got dropped off one Saturday morning. My brother asked me if I fancied a run, and he was playing for the under-11s at the time, and I turned up and he ran off to train with them and left me. Didn't know anybody, didn't have any friends. Burst into tears. And
how old were you?
I was 7. I do remember playing on there on a Wednesday night against Lee East. And it'd been rearranged from a Sunday, and it was really warm. I think it was probably one of the first times it had been about under 13s, under 14s, first time I'd really had pasta before a game, and just remember having so much energy, and you know, it was a good night for us. We got a great win, and we'd spend most of Sunday in and around our game, so really good family club.
And do you think this place will create a few future Kevin Sinfields?
I hope there's not many more of me, because I'm full of OCD and a bit complicated, I suppose, but I think the older Mary is renowned for developing good players, and you know, you look at the likes of Yestin Harris and Barry McDermott, Paul Sculthorpe, to name three there, they've all been fantastic players and great internationals, and they've all come from this area. So. Go!
Take us through it.
Yeah, basically I use a telescopic tee, just so you can see, there's a bar in the middle. I use that as my guide, so I line that up where, for me here, another post will be straight through the middle, so we place that down. I talk about this being a bullet, and basically if you look down the barrel of a gun, you've got a gun sight, so you've got, we make rugby balls with four panels for us, which is fantastic, so you look down the barrel of a gun, and you see your crosshair. So basically I try and use that, I try and use the lines on the ball as well as the line in the middle of the tee. For me, I always have my middle finger on the valve when I'm placing it, on my left hand. Just so you know, no, you don't need to know it, it's just part of the OCD. And basically I'm lining the ball up, the seam of the ball, straight through the middle. Knowing full well, this bullet, if I hit it right in the right spot, it's going to go straight. Coaching points, when I'm talking to kids about kicking, you can have any run up you want. You can come from those posts, you can do one step. It doesn't matter.
You come from over there somewhere.
I come from over here, yeah. First one's relax. Second one's keep your head down. And the third one is follow through. So when I'm following through, I'm trying to touch my right leg, my right foot with my left hand, so my follow through's there. So I know, be at the bottom of the ball, the right spot, with that follow through, I'll go straight through and the ball will go straight. Fire away, go for it.
Follow through, head down, follow through. There you go.
There we go.
Go. Head wasn't that down, was it, really?
You wanted to see where we were going, didn't you?
I did, actually.
I'm going to go, Jonesy. Don't tear that quad.
Don't tear my quad. I can't remember. All I can remember is putting my finger on the hole.
I'm lining it up. I usually just malm and inger it with toe bang it, but I'm just trying to do it best like Kev. I've got to wipe my foot with my sock. I'm a big deep breath.
Nice.
Yummy.
There we go. Two from two.
You know, to be fair to Kev, he's not the biggest, he's not the fastest, he's not the strongest, but he's as big as he can be, as strong as he can be, as fast as he can be, and he's actually made himself, you know, as good as he can be in every aspect of his performance, and it's just sheer down to preparation.
Kev's been like a professional, full-time professional from being 12, 13 years old. He's had absolutely everything covered, from, you know, what he eats, what he sleeps, his preparation, his kit. Absolutely everything is just all there.
And he speaks his mind and he's honest and blunt with people, which, you know, in our kind of environment you need, in a team environment, people need to be told when they're doing things right, doing things wrong, and he's very good at that as well, and he's a pretty disciplined person.
He understands hard work and he's never ashamed to do it. You know, and that doesn't, when he's been in the game for as long as he has, you might think you'd take the odd easy day. I don't think he does. And I think he's grateful every day to be able to be paid to play the sport he loves.
I just feel really, really fortunate. Been really lucky in some of the teams I've played in, and some of the players I've played alongside, and some of the coaches I've played under. So, you know, to be looking down the barrel now at 2013 of hopefully a successful club campaign, and then, like I've touched on, what's to come for England at the end of the year, to have a chance to create some history, I think is huge. And I'm no spring chicken, so the likelihood is it would surely be my last World Cup, my last chance. And it's been that long since England have really accomplished anything. Certainly with the Southern Hemisphere, big teams involved. You know, why not this year? Why not? I think it's a great opportunity for all of us, and you know, hopefully I'll be involved come November the 30th, which is a date now that we talk about quite a bit, but come November the 30th, we'll all be smiling.
And obviously seeing him be named England captain this year is real special, because when you think about destiny, somebody like Kevin Sinfield, the calibre of Kevin Sinfield, you can almost imagine, can't you, that it'd be part of his destiny to do something like win a World Cup.
I just don't detect in him any arrogance, I don't detect any complacency, and instead I just see somebody who's honest and hardworking and sort of represents all of the attributes that good, strong, honest sport should, and for me rugby league is that.
The way we can make it a successful World Cup is for England to play well, for England to perform, but ultimately to win it. That's how we can do
our job,
so we can play our part. Is it realistic? Yeah, we believe so. I know there'll be a whole host of people, certainly from down under, but a lot of people in the UK as well who doubt whether we're good enough, whether there's enough belief, whether the strength and depth is there. I think what Steve McNamara's put in place, along with the RFL and plenty of other members of staff that are involved now, they've recruited the best in every area, and there'll be no stone unturned in the quest for World Cup success. And I think the pool of players that's available now, when you include the NRL-based English qualified players and the young players we've got through coming here, added to the already core of sort of senior lads we've got, I think competition for places is as strong as I can remember. And when you add to that the environment now, the culture, the togetherness of the group, you throw all them ingredients together, and for me looking at it, some might say I'm very optimistic, but for me looking at it, knowing what's going on in there inside, I think we've got a great show.